Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Just before we have our swearing in of our new officer, I'd like to have a moment of silence for Jerry McConnell, a longtime Hampton resident who passed away this past week. Thank you.
Chief. Mr. Chairman, it's an honor and a privilege to come before the board again with our newest officer to swear in. Jay Papalotto comes from a long history of law enforcement members. His brother actually started his career with us and is a member of the Salem Police Department, and his father is here in attendance, Sergeant Rick Papalotto from the Rockingham County Sheriff's Department, who works frequently with us down here at the beach during the busy summer months. So at this time, I'm going to ask Officer Papalotto to come up front and center to take the oath, and Town Clerk Jane Seifert to administer the oath.
From the town of Hampton in the county of Rockingham to J. M. Papalotto of Salem, New Hampshire in the county of Rockingham. Whereas there is a vacancy in the office of full-time police officer in said town, and whereas we, the subscribers, have confidence in your ability and integrity to perform the duties of said office, we do hereby appoint you, the said J. M. Papalotto, as full-time police officer of said town, and upon your taking the oath of office and having this appointment and the certificate of said oath of office recorded by the town clerk, you shall have the powers, perform the duties, and be subject to the liabilities of such office until another person shall be chosen and qualified in your stead. Given under my hand this 27th day of February 2017, Fred Welch, Town Manager. Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, J. M. Papalotto.
I, J. M. Papalotto.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
Discharge and perform.
Discharge and perform.
All the duties incumbent upon me.
All the duties incumbent upon me.
As full-time police officer.
As full-time police officer.
According to the best of my abilities.
According to the best of my abilities.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Of this Constitution.
Of this Constitution.
And the laws of the state of New Hampshire.
And the laws of the state of New Hampshire.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Sergeant Rick Papalotto, come on up and put the badge on your son. They always say, blood is okay.
Chief Sawyer, Deputy Chief Hobbs, for the opportunity to be here. I'd also like to thank all the selectmen. I'd also like to thank my parents for being more than supportive with me throughout this entire process. I'm really looking forward to starting my career here in Hampton, finishing a long, long time in the future. Thank you all very much.
Those that are here for the swearing in, if you want to take pictures, the board does have a busy agenda, so we'd ask everybody that was here for that to move upstairs so they can finish with their.
It's very good.
Yeah, I'm glad we do it that way.
Yeah. He has every chance to see him.
Yeah, it's good.
It's a good show. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thanks, John.
time, we will we'll open a public hearing, RSA 40, 14, 4, and RSA 40, 14-B, 11, semicolon B. The question of proposed a warrant article 43 delegating the determination of the default budget to the Municipal Budget Committee instead of the Board of Selectmen. Anybody from the audience would like to get up and speak?
Good evening. You should be announcing the time that you open the public hearing just in case. Well, I'm not by that o'clock. Just in case something should come up in court and whatever it pays to document. Good evening. Mary Louise Woolsey, 148 Little River Road. Mr. Pierce and I submitted this private petition article after our experience this year with the Budget Committee. It is the authority to create the default budget is granted to the Budget Committee by statute, and there are usually a number of Budget Committee members who are quite competent in math. So we thought it might be the time to let the Budget Committee go ahead and start preparing the default budget, which is very critical, as I mentioned at the deliberative session. The public does look to the default budget to figure out whether or not they're going to vote for the operating budget, so they need something accurate. This should save perhaps a little time for the finance office, which is at its busiest at that time of year. So we will appreciate having the voters support Article 43.
Anybody else like to speak for the public hearing?
All right. Sure. Jerry Zanoy here, 16 Presidential Circle. I did endorse this article. I signed the sheet of paper that came around. There's several things that have concerned me about the default budget in years past, and that's the first thing is that everybody scrutinizes the heck out of the operating budget, but somehow the default budget just seems to blow through quick reviews here at the Board of Selectmen, and end of the review session in January or February with the Budget Committee. Well, not enough time is allotted to really go through that line by line, in my opinion. There's 420 line items, plus or five or so, in the operating budget. And when when the operating budget fails, last year's budget should pick up. And in addition to that, contractual line items. And how many real contractual line items do we have? Not very many, in my opinion. All the wages are certainly contractual. What we sign up for, police and fire contracts, for 3-year contracts or 2-year contracts, those are contractual, no doubt about it. If we get into an office equipment warranty program for 2 or 3 years, that may be considered contractual. But how many really are contractual? And what I hear at the deliberative session several times was, how come if we vote the operating budget down, the budget increases the next year? How is that? We tell them, well, it's last year's budget plus contractual line items, but there aren't that many. One thing that I don't like is the fact that we have given sizable raises in the mid-year, after the approval of the budget, we've given raises, $10,000 raises in some cases to people. We've hired assistant town managers in September of 2014. All of that money goes into next year's default budget. Automatically, we have nothing to say about it. It's in there, it's costs that are in the default budget. Nobody thinks about counteracting that increase with reduction somewhere. We just add to the costs. $80,000 for an assistant town manager plus fringe benefit, nobody improved on, except the selectmen. Therein, that cost is in next year's budget, 15 and 16, 17, and so on. And so aren't the raises. But we don't turn around and look to where to reduce costs anywhere to compensate for that fact. We just add to the costs. And I wonder if you consider something like utility cost contractual. So the utility cost for energy goes up every year, let's say in the new police station. What are we doing about that? Is there an energy audit being performed? Is any corrective measures being taken? Or do we just simply raise it up and say it's contractual? That's what concerns me. about a default budget. That default budget should be scrutinized just as closely as the operating budget to give our taxpayers a fair shake here. I don't see that happening. I think we've lost the definition of prudence and fiscal conservatism. I really have. Thank you.
Anybody else who wants to speak?
I'm Pierce, 84 Lock Road. And this year, because the budget committee's schedule was kind of disrupted by a three-week delay in getting the budget, it gave us an opportunity to scrutinize the budget and compare the budget with last year's budget more closely. And because the default budget's right there in the Excel spreadsheet right next to everything else, it's easy to compare. And we did, and we found several discrepancies. We brought that to the finance director's attention, and she corrected almost all of it. And that's my first point. And so that means, going back to my first point, is in public, you gentlemen didn't really scrutinize the default budget, at least in public. It was less than a minute from time it was introduced to the time you approved it. So there was no discussion, there was no questions, there was no nothing, which indicates to me there wasn't much effort put into that. I'm not finding fault with that, because when I was a selectman, we didn't put much effort into looking at the default budget either. Because we just assumed, make sure you get the assumed part, that it was following the state statutes. Well, this year when we were examining, we found that was not the case. So putting both these two issues together, I think it's time for the Budget Committee to take a close look at the default budget and have the time to scrutinize it, because everything's right next to each other when we're looking at the budget anyway. So there'd be very little effort use there to do that function, whereas you guys have the administrative privileges of looking out for the provident affairs of the town. So putting that all in mind, I think we should leave you to administer and let the Budget Committee do the Budget Committee. And thank you very much, and I hope everybody supports this warrant article. Thank you.
Is there anybody else from the public that would like to get up and speak?
Good evening. Always a pleasure being in this room. This warrant article, in my view, would take the creation of the default warrant article and place it rightfully where default budgets belong, in a budget committee. If you have a budget committee, you would think the budget committee would make budgets. Well, we have a default. We have a budget warrant article every year, as all SB2 towns do, in which there are two budgets in that warrant article. One is the proposed operating budget, which is produced by the Budget Committee. The other is the default budget, which is not produced by the Budget Committee. Kind of an oddity. You might wonder where this oddity came from. Well, this thing called SB2, which created the ability to have all warrant articles, budget included, to be placed on a ballot, as opposed to having it inside of a deliberative session where it's actually decided in the old-fashioned town meeting. This was changed in the mid-90s. And as state legislatures do, they made this new provision, and of course it's rather complex, changed a lot of existing laws. Kind of like Obamacare, changed a lot of laws and a lot of flaws. One of those flaws was it gave the default budget creation to the governing body, or the selectmen, as opposed to the Budget Committee. Less than 10 years later, the state legislature, seeing the error in their way, created this provision in the law that allows the town to return the creation of the budget to the Budget Committee. The whole of it, not just half of it. Right now the Budget Committee is functioning basically in a two-legged race with one leg. And it produces an unnecessary degree of friction between the governing body and the Budget Committee. Because there are no clear bounds of authority or responsibility between the governing body and the budget committee. When there are clear lines of responsibility, there are far less chance of friction. But what you see is a repeated intensity of friction that occurs every year, starting around October until around February, every year. And it's partly because of this friction point between the inability to discern just who is responsible for what. Again, the state legislature saw that error, and they provided the provision, which, of course, this warrant article is intended to do, which is to give the default budget. By the way, an idea that a default budget, you know what that comes from? They had to make it up for SB 2, because in order to put something on the ballot, it has to be a yes or no question. So what do you do when you say no to the operating budget? You have to have some reaction, and that reaction is a default budget. It has been said by people that the default budget is nothing more than a simple formula of last year's budget, plus or minus, whatever. But it's actually got a lot more discretion in it than that, and has been used with some degree of liberal discretion, shall we say. The budget committee has far more members of the Board of Selectmen. We have an ability to have more eyes on the default budget. Now, I know, Mr. Chairman, that your body has already decided on this without deliberation, and it's now too late to change your mind on the ballot. So I'm primarily speaking to the audience because I'm interested in the public understanding the situation here. And the situation is simply that the budget committee ought to define budgets. If you're going to have a budget committee, like the Hampton Union said, we really ought to keep the budget committee. Well, we ought to keep it whole in terms of its responsibilities. Like the old days, the budget committee was responsible for the entire budget warrant article being brought to deliberative session. Let's return to that. The budget committee is responsible for budgets. It only makes sense. We will spend far more time scrutinizing the default budget as we do the operating budget than the governing body does, because, frankly, the governing body is busy doing governing body stuff, and that's a lot of stuff you guys got to do. Don't need to burden you with that. We've already got some degree of expertise on the budget committee to handle it, and we're happy to do it. I thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing, and I'll say good night.
Thank you. Anybody else from the public that would like to get up and speak? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the board. Is there anybody on the board that wants to speak? Regina?
You want to speak?
Just briefly. Number one, you know, there are some points brought up by people that are valid points. There are some points that aren't valid points. I mean, the budget is the default budget is laid out how it should be formed, and it is formulas and one-time things are taken out. What Mr. Zanoy said could be a question about raises taking place mid-year. I'm against that not being in the budget, but that would have nothing to do with the default budget because it's in the default budget anyways. So, you know, I think the default budget, if somebody thinks that something has been done incorrectly with the default budget, they can report it to the DRA and go from there. Has that ever been done? Have we had that? So is there a problem with the default budget? No, there has not been a problem with the default budget. So why switch something that's working? Some people have a problem with other things, but not the default budget, and they want to control it by the default budget. So leave it as it is.
Jim?
Yeah, I just wanted to, on something that was said, and I'm sorry, I don't remember if it was Mr. Jones or Mr. Zanoy that said it, but the default budget, you know, things being added to it liberally, I just wish that maybe if someone had a specific concern about a line item, I think there was a couple that they addressed to Christy, and Christy got them answers, and, you know, she recalculated something. But I just wish this should have been discussed at the Budget Committee, not now, not foaming it out to force the public to decide whether or not this should happen. This is all information that it should have presented in the public hearings that started whenever the Budget Committee received the budget, the beginning of November. And I don't agree with it, this even being brought up right now. Thank you.
Rick?
Phil? Yeah, it's good to see my good friends again. And Jerry won't be long before I see you down the beach with the grandkids. I served as liaison to the Budget Committee. My first meeting, I strictly spoke to the Budget Committee's performance of coming in at the 11th hour and cutting hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars from the budget on the night before or the very night that they were doing their budget hearing. The department heads had come in all throughout the budget process to that Budget Committee. Most of the members are still on the board. The department heads were never asked about that. The Board of Selectmen were never asked about that. Nobody was ever informed about that. The town manager wasn't informed about that. I was accused of being mean to the Budget Committee when all I did was simply speak to the facts of the execution phase of their maneuvering. And they thought that it was mean, but I was simply speaking as I do now. I didn't approve of that. I thought it was disrespectful to the taxpayer. I thought it was not in terms and not in keeping with transparency. There have been transparency issues with the Budget Committee this year. We've addressed those. Hopefully that they're not continuing. I respect Jerry's input into the legislative process, if you will, here in this town. The budget's up less than 1%. Budget's up less than 1%. I don't think that's fiscal mismanagement. Jerry talks about hiring somebody midstream, the assistant town manager. I was chairman of the board then. Jerry neglects that we lost somebody. God bless Wanda Robinson. We had an employee die. She was the assistant town council. It actually saved the town money, this expenditure that Jerry, moments ago, Jerry says cost us money. Additionally, the new billet holder brought 30 years of municipal experience, hot-seated, is now the personnel director, the assistant town manager, and assumed all of Wanda's duties and more. And it's been a tremendous asset. So I don't support this. I could go on. I could go on. I could go on. Mary Louise started the issue tonight by saying we should have the time because in case this goes to court. I've been the recipient of Mary Louise's court intentions before. The whole board has been. I don't support it. The board, the town voted last year to reduce the Budget Committee. There's a warrant on for this year to eliminate it. We'll see what happens. And I do not support this measure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, seeing I will close this public hearing at
7:23.
There you go, 7:23. Public comment period. Is there anybody here who'd like to speak from the public?
Mr. Chairman, you note the time when you close the public hearing before the board makes comments after they've heard the public hearing. Just so you know, because you never can tell what might end up in court.
At never know.
The Budget Committee's meeting on January 31st, Selectman Barnes made a very impassioned peroration regarding the her notes, apparently that weren't shared with the rest of you, related to the conversation with Attorney Gerald regarding the 91A dispute at that meeting, and it is on tape. Members of the Budget Committee asked for a copy. You were at that meeting, Mr. Chairman. The Budget Committee members asked for a copy. I have not seen a copy yet. I did send a reminder email to Selectman Barnes and received no response. So I'm asking once again, in behalf of the Budget Committee, if she will please fulfill their request this week and get a copy of the six odd pages of handwritten notes that were read to the Budget Committee. Number two, regarding the 91A mess, you and I have known each other for a long time, Mr. Chairman. Looking back, I think it was insulting to the Municipal Budget Committee that either you or Attorney Gerald could not have picked up the phone and called me. You have scared and upset all of the members of the Budget Committee. I am the one who did all of the emails. Selectman Barnes had the emails that I sent in her computer. I think that what was done was directed at me, and the Budget Committee took the fallout, which is not acceptable. I am going to ask you to have the Town Council release a statement. You have printouts of almost everybody's emails and so forth, and you could have just gone into Regina's emails and not bothered the rest of us. The Hampton Union does have copies of my emails that I provided to you. I would like to see a statement from Town Council clearing the members of the Budget Committee of any problem. And if you want to go after me, gentlemen, man up and do it in public.
Anybody else would like to speak publicly? Public comment.
There's annoying again. Just a quick comment here. Jim, if we didn't give the mid-year raises or hire mid-year people, that money would not be in the following year's default budget. But by doing it, it goes in automatically. And as far as Bean's comments, yes, we did have an open billet. You're right. And the decision was to replace it with Chief Sullivan, assistant town manager, making him assistant town manager. But there was a significant difference in the cost. We had to get those costs changed twice to get them accurate. There was an assumption that Mrs. Robinson was being given a significant raise, which she couldn't have been given because she's no longer with us at the time. And so it was misrepresented in terms of the cost differential. There was a significant cost differential between that addition and what Mrs. Robinson had at her position. So I watch these things very carefully when I'm on the Budget Committee, which I wasn't this past year. But I think that this is just an over-interpretation of what's contractual and what isn't. And mid-year moves with wages, significant wages, and additions really affect the following year's default budget, because they wouldn't be in that budget. Those costs wouldn't be in that budget and approved by the electorate or submitted to the electorate if they weren't done in the mid-year. That's what bothers me. It doesn't seem to be right to doing that. You give a budget to people in March, they approve it, and then we jack it up by a lot of dollars with these wage increases in mid-year, especially in 2014. And now I see it happening in 15 and 16. Thank you.
Anybody else would like to speak for public comment? Surprise, surprise.
Michael Pierce, 84 Lock Road. And in relation to Regina's remarks about the default budget, things were different in there. There was 40 or 50 some items, okay, in the default budget that were corrected by the finance director. So I want to make sure that that's on the public record. Thank you.
Anybody else would like to speak?
Mr. Chairman, I thought I might hang around and correct something that might have been stated accurately. The chairman of the Budget Committee stated that everyone on the Budget Committee was upset and scared. I wasn't. I wasn't aware of a survey being done on the question of that, for that matter. But I certainly wasn't. I knew what was happening 9 months ago. I was informed that there would be a warrant article put out there to eliminate the Budget Committee. And I knew that all the attacks that Mary Louise likes to think were personal. They weren't personal. They were all part of preparing the public mind to engender hatred for the Budget Committee so that they could vote yes on getting rid of the Budget Committee. That's the reason, isn't it? Absolutely. Because I, too, have some information on the side that I get from people that you are not aware of, Selectman. And this warrant article to eliminate the Budget Committee was conceived 12 months ago and was beginning to be written up 9 months ago. All of this kangaroo court that has taken place in this body, having the lawyer come in and say, oh, yes, this is what the law says, and oh, the Budget Committee is doing this wrong and that wrong, yet when all the evidence that you requested from us is given to you,
Mr. Chairman,
there are no facts put forth that say why we're guilty. One wonders if you're going to have a show trial on the Budget Committee that you don't invite someone from the Budget Committee to represent their position.
You can make your point.
I am making my point.
And let's.
I appreciate that. I appreciate the opportunity for public comment. I appreciate there being a democratic process. Very much, Mr. Chairman. And the Budget Committee is made up of members who are elected, except for the three appointees, and some selectmen like to condemn appointees, but the three appointees, one of which is on your body that you appoint. So, not everyone in the Budget Committee was scared or afraid of the actions that you took, because some of us actually saw the game as you were playing it. And that's why all of us didn't respond to the garbage that was coming out of these kangaroo courtrooms you've been holding for the last few months. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else want to speak in public comment? Seeing none, I'll bring it back to the board for comment.
Community calendar?
Sure. Events and community calendar.
Good. I just want to remind everyone, 2 weeks from tomorrow is full day and a good resource for people. Obviously, the town website, but also In the Know Hampton. They're on Facebook, and you can also Google them. And it pretty much explains all the Warren articles, what happens if you say yes, what happens if you say no. So it's a good way to research and be prepared when you go into vote so you don't have to read everything for the first time. And that's it. Thank you.
Jim.
This is vacation week. There are children out around all day long, not in school. So please drive safely. Pay attention. Also, I believe March 7th is going to be a candidates night. And that will be televised. Yes?
Yes.
Right. So it's an opportunity for everybody to listen to the different candidates and what they have to offer. Coming up for the election, and the election is on March 14th, so please pay attention to that. Please get out and vote, and be an intelligent voter, please. Thank you.
Phil.
Yeah, just extrapolating on Jerry McConnell. For those that didn't know Jerry in town, and there was a nice write-up in the paper, he was a Marine that hit Guadalcanal, and that, in this day and age, is almost like within 2 or 3 decades, knowing somebody that fought at Gettysburg. And that was one hell of a battle. It was the first against the Japanese by American forces, land forces. They were left on that island for months. The Navy had to pull away because it was a naval battle. And they were left there for months and months. And Jerry was a tremendous, tremendous American, a tremendous Marine, and a tremendous, tremendous public servant of Hampton. And I know that he watches some of these meetings from up there, and has probably got a little chuckle, but there's a guy that was hooking and jabbing when it was important, and he came back here and did God's work in his town. God bless him. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Rick?
Yes. I would just like to point out, it was reported in the Hampton Union that all 5 members of the board supported the end of the Budget Committee, the private Warren article. I abstained from it. I did. It was 4-1-4-0-1. As I abstained from all of the private Warren articles. I personally don't feel that we should be weighing in on private Warren articles because we've had nothing to do with them. So I just want to point that out. Thank you.
Okay, I have a one thing here. The Hampton Area Lions Club is holding their winter auction on Saturday, March 4th. Which is a Saturday at the Ashworth by the Sea. Number of things to bid on, Fisher Cat tickets, clothing, gift certificates, the Ogunquit Playhouse Theater, the Ashworth, LeMay's, and even parasailing tickets. So the doors open at 6. The admission is $15. And that's, for the Hampton Area Lions Club, their winter auction. And just to reiterate, we don't forget voting is on March 14th, and it's going to be at the Winneconnet High School. We have 44 Warren articles this year, which is down a little bit from last year, but they're all important. You know, you get out there, make an educated vote. Get all the information you can. Regina said there's a website out there in the know, Hampton. It doesn't tell you how to vote. Doesn't tell you to vote yes. Doesn't tell you to vote no on anything. Doesn't add any political comment. It just tells you what the people voting for it, or what the people supporting it, and what the people are opposed to it. Gives you that bit of information. That's all that's out there. So I'd encourage anybody to look at what's out there. I believe the sample ballots, there are a few of them upstairs already. The town clerk was working on those today. The town reports are in Uptown. If you get a chance to pick up the town report, you can find the Warren articles in there. And also you can find out what went on, and you can see the whole budget. Everything is posted in there. Or again, you can go to the website. Town of Hampton's website, where the town report is in there also. So, okay. Next thing is a consent agenda. We have veterans credits for blind, disabled, and elderly exemptions. We have a RPC Transportation Advisory Committee appointment. We have a raffle permit for community oven. We have an entertainment license for the 401. We have the use of the selectman's room for the PTA Candidates Night on November 7th, and we have the 2017 sewer abatements.
So moved.
Motion by Rick, seconded by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous. Next thing we have the minutes of February 6th. And we have the minutes of February, well, let's do them one at a time. Minutes of February 6th.
So moved.
So moved by Bill, seconded by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous. Next one's February 13th, the minutes.
So moved.
Moved by Jim, seconded by Rick. All those in favor? Unanimous. Next one we have appointments. One Sky Community Services.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Thank you for allowing me to meet with you this evening. In the past, I have always appeared here in my role as either the chairperson of the Hampton Democratic Committee or as a state representative. And tonight, I'm here as the chief executive officer of One Sky Community Services, a position that I've held since 2015. I'm sure some of you, and probably many of the people watching at home, are wondering who or what is One Sky Community Services? That's a very fair question, because over the years, we have not done a good enough job of letting people know who we are and what we do. And that is really my main purpose in being here tonight. One Sky Community Services is a private, nonprofit New Hampshire corporation that's been part of the Seacoast community since 1983. We believe in the intrinsic value of every human being, and we are committed to helping our friends, family members, and neighbors with developmental disabilities and acquired brain disorders live a personally fulfilling and successful life within their own community. Through our contract with the state of New Hampshire, we are the area agency designated to provide state and federally funded Medicaid services to eligible individuals and families living in the 24 cities and towns in Rockingham County that we cover. Hampton is one of those communities, and we currently provide supports and services to about 70 individuals and families living in our community. In total, we serve about 1,000 individuals and families across all 24 of the cities and towns in our service area. And we receive approximately $23 million from the state of New Hampshire to enable us to do so. We're very grateful for that support. That funding enables us to provide a range of services, including early intervention supports to families of young children who have been diagnosed with a developmental disability, and probably the two most easily recognizable developmental disabilities are autism or Down syndrome. We work with school districts such as the Hampton and Winnicott School District to assist children with developmental disabilities between the age of 3 and 21 by offering them and their families in-home supports. And we assist individuals over the age of 21 by helping them develop a service plan to meet their needs in a community-based setting, where we then work with the state to secure the necessary resources to enable them to live independently, help those individuals and families who are interested in managing their service program themselves to do so, connect them with other service providers in the area who might be able to help them, manage all the service providers that are working with them, and help individuals find meaningful employment.
Over the years, the funding that we've received from the state has unfortunately not kept up with the growing demand for services or lack or rate of inflation. Individuals we serve are living longer. In the past, if somebody was diagnosed with Down syndrome, they were usually told that they would live until they're maybe 30 or 40, and now they're living into their 60s and 70s. The mortality rate among high-risk newborns has declined, so we're getting more and more children with issues coming into the system. Since 2005, the incidence of autism has increased by 11% per year. The lack of mental health funding in the state has driven individuals with a dual diagnosis to our system because we're able to help them. And overall, the number of people receiving services increased by nearly 60% between 2006 and 2015. And there's not been an adjustment in the rates paid for those services in the last 10 years. Our budget today is approximately 6% lower than it was in fiscal year 2015. Add to that the very real crisis that we're facing trying to find and hire staff to provide services to the population we serve, and the level of services we're able to provide is being impacted. The bottom line is that the quality of the services that we provide to our clients, at least 70 of whom are family, friends, and neighbors living right here in Hampton, are that the services that they're receiving are being impacted. That's why we're doing three things. We're getting out and educating members of the community and the state legislature about the needs of the people we serve and the important contributions they can make to the fabric of our communities. We're seeking out partnerships with local businesses and other human services and community-based organizations to create new opportunities for the people we serve to participate in their communities. And wherever possible, we're trying to fill the gap that exists between what the people we serve need and what is available to them through state and federally funded programs. The handout that I gave you includes an organizational overview, our annual report, and a description of the One Sky Readiness Fund, which was created to directly address those critical needs that are currently not funded. Funding the Readiness Fund is a priority for One Sky because of the gap in services that many of our clients are now facing. For things like real and meaningful employment training and long-term supports, solutions to the transportation challenges they're facing getting from home to work, dental services which are not covered by Medicaid, gas, food, and heating vouchers, and educational camp sponsorships. And then also things like that all of us take for granted, things like being able to go to the movie or go to a play or other things to participate in the community. As the resource in the area for Hampton families with a individual with developmental disability or acquired brain disorder, I want to invite anyone living in Hampton who is looking for our help to contact us at 603-436-6111. We're hoping that this time next year, we will be able to add ourselves to the list of human service agencies that are receiving funding from the residents of Hampton through the town warrant. In the meantime, I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have here tonight. And since March is Developmental Disabilities Awareness Month, I would invite you and the viewers at home to go to our website, www.oneskyservices.org, to learn more about us, and if you're able to do so, make a donation to the One Sky Readiness Fund. So thank you for your time, and as I said, I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Very good. Gina.
Thank you for the presentation. Sure. It's, not familiar with this at all. It's very noble work you do, and I look forward to looking into it.
Great.
Thank you.
I think the first week on the job, somebody asked me where I work, and I said One Sky, and they said, "What is that? A satellite TV company?"
Thank you. Great organization and great work you do. I know that when somebody ages out at 21 and they have to find other services and stuff, it's really tough. Jobs are really tough. Transportation's really tough. So you know, it's a tough road you guys are doing, but it's got to be done, and hopefully people will help out with it.
One of the biggest challenges we have is that the way the system is set up in New Hampshire, from the age of 3 to 21, the educational system, the local school boards are responsible for taking care of the individuals. At 21, literally overnight, we become primary. And because of some of the uncertainties around funding, all too often, the services that somebody had when they were 20 and 364 days ends, and we're not able to pick it up for a long period of time. That creates a real problem for people.
Bill.
Yeah, great organization.
Thank you.
You were a rep?
I was, for a very short period of time.
Well, good to see you. Good to see you, young man. And yeah, your revenue's up. Do you work with our welfare department? I know they're separate issues, but do you work?
I think we have some interaction with the welfare department, but I think probably, quite frankly, the most interaction that we have locally is probably with the Winneconne Special Ed Department.
Got it.
Because as the kids turn, as they start aging out of the system, we start trying to work with them as soon as we can to make the transition as easy as possible.
Thank you. And I can't command all aspects of important detail and minutia, but are you in for money on the warrant this year?
No, we're not.
And you say 70 families. Do you have a ballpark on what the dollar value is of your service to families in Hampton? You don't have to get that now, but
I mean, the average, you know, the average, if you do the arithmetic, the average is about $20,000 per person. Mm-hmm. So that's what, 100, and, can't do the math, is that 140,000 or 1.4 million? I can't remember. I think it's 140,000.
In direct aid to local families, give or take. Yeah, very nice job. Thank you. Okay. Interested to look at your website. And thanks for what you do.
Thank you.
Good to see you, Chris.
Director.
Yeah, it sounds like it's a wonderful organization. I see that you've got some really nice people like Nancy Claiborne there. She's great. She was one of my clients when I had a business in Portsmouth. And I know she's got people in her family that it's a special journey for her. And I have a sister that's 60 years old that is mentally handicapped. And she suffered, you know, it becomes a burden for, even though they may get care and Medicare or what Medicaid, but they don't get dental care and stuff like that. It's so important, and we were always able to handle it for my sister. And she still lives independently at home, in her own home, but she lives where my sister lives, and it's a lifelong thing. So these families here in Hampton do need help. And what about, if they haven't been on the list?
Need a petitioned article.
Don't they have to do a petition for the first year?
They do.
And then they become
permanent,
a regular after that.
No, it's one of our goals for next year is to make sure that we're getting on as many of the article on the warrant articles as we can.
Don't wait till December to do it. Start in September, October. Okay.
And I've watched this for my sister when she was a little girl. It has changed so much over the last 60 years. And today, these people have so many more opportunities. And it's good to see that.
Well, New Hampshire is still, you know, New Hampshire was the first state in the country to close its institutions and adopt a program of allowing people with developmental disabilities to live in the community. And we're still one of the leading states in the country. And the challenge is that it becomes more and more expensive to do that. And, you know, we need our friends in Concord, Representative Bean, to help us out.
And there's a lot of people that live in Hampton that have these kids that are adults living with them when they become senior citizens, and they all need help. So thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you for coming in. I'm glad you've kind of peeked your nose in and shown us a little bit, and it's important that the people out there go to your website, see what's going on.
Thank you.
See the important work you do, and we're looking forward to seeing a warrant article early next fall for
excellent
to help you out.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Town Manager's Report.
Mr. Chairman, certainly want to make these announcements again. We're at the 27th of February. Tomorrow's the 28th. Day following is the 1st of March. And that is the last day that any citizen in the town who owns property, residential property or commercial property, can file for a tax abatement on their assessments with the assessor's office. If you do not file by March 1st, you are precluded by statute from filing for any taxes for the previous calendar year, forever. So it's important that if you have a situation where you wish to challenge your taxes, that you do that by March 1st. Forms are available in the assessor's office.
Also, by April 15th, that's the last day that property owners may file for elderly, veterans, blind, solar, and other exemptions that are allowed by statute. And also on the 15th is the last day that charitable organizations must file their property inventory forms. April 15th is also the last day for the application for current use taxation, and it's the last day to file for the Hampton Beach Precinct tax abatement. For those who wish to file for any of the items listed above, please come to the assessor's office early, as the forms you need to be filled out and filed with your request, along with the necessary backup documents to verify your eligibility for the exemption. And all that has to be done before the deadline dates. The supervisors of the checklist will be in session in the Hampton Town office on Tuesday, March 7th, 2017, from 1 to 2 p.m. to register new voters and to make changes and corrections to the voter checklist. When registering to vote, residents must provide a photo ID and proof of age, domicile, and citizenship. For naturalized citizens, naturalized papers are required, or naturalization papers are required, excuse me. Residents may also register to vote and make corrections and changes to the voter information at the town clerk's office during normal business hours until that time. No new registrations will be accepted between March 7th and March 14th, which is election day by state law. Mr. Chairman, there are a couple of other things. That the board needs to be made aware of. We've received a notice from Rockingham County commissioners that they are considering changing the fiscal year for the county taxes, which means that at some point in time we're going to receive three tax bills in a year. They've got this pretty well scheduled so that it's not going to affect anything on our tax rate, but it will change the amount of cash that we collect and hold during the course of the year, which could in fact increase the amount of money we borrow, have to borrow in lieu of taxes. Just so people understand the process, we bill twice a year. The first half tax bill comes in the spring, usually due by July 1st. That's the last day it should be due. And that is one half of the previous year's tax. And then the state sets the tax rate per thousand in the fall, and we bill again usually in October or November, and that's usually due December 1st. We're on one fiscal year, and the school is on another fiscal year. So we collect 6 months of the worth of their taxes to pay to them from January through June, through the end of June. We hold that money. It's paid by the taxpayers. We hold that money, and we actually revolve that in the town's checking account so we don't have to borrow. That goes with the county as well. If the county changes the fiscal year, that money will not be held in the account, and it may result in some borrowing by the town to pay taxes and pay our bills during the course of the year. So everybody should keep an eye on what's going on with the county taxes, just in case we end up having to borrow funds in the future because we may not have cash available, as is normally done during the course of the year. Mr. Chairman, I signed a letter for the Pease Authority for the harbor. We had discussed this briefly, and I'd given you some information on it. The harbor is badly silted in. The Pease International Authority, the Ports and Harbors Division, has requested that the Corps of Engineers dredge the harbor again. The last dredging was in 2012-13. And they took out 168,000 cubic yards of material out of the harbor at the cost of $3.2 million. The United States Army Corps of Engineers has indicated that they have no time scheduled in the future and no cash available in the future to dredge the harbor. It is already closing down for the commercial fishing vessels, and we're afraid it's going to be closing down for the private vessels as well in the summertime because it's filling rapidly. I think if you look over in the just about where the town line is with Seabrook, which is called the middle ground, you'll see that's already starting to be chewed in half again by the water coming down from Salisbury and the river. So we're having some severe problems out there. I did sign a letter asking Senator Shaheen to assist us in getting funds to help dredge the harbor so that we can keep, and the harbor authority, it's I think they're a little low, but they indicated the financial impact and losses would be $91 million per year, including wages. It would also have damage to our fireboat and the police boats and the Coast Guard vessels and the state vessels that frequent that area. We'd also received a note from several people, as well as the state, who was very concerned about the fact that the Sun Valley shoreline, particularly around the bridge across the harbor, is eroding very quickly. There's 110 linear feet of displacement and 85 linear feet of displacement for the jetty on the south side of the river, which is causing some severe problems, and is probably going to have to be corrected. Just so everybody knows, I know there's a general concept that jetty, the low tide jetty, is the town's. It is not. It belongs to the state of New Hampshire. I've seen the information from the Army Corps of Engineers that when it was built, it was turned over by the Army to the state, so they have maintenance responsibilities there. And that is causing some problems with the erosion that's going on down there now. And that has something to do with the displacement of the jetty, because it has been moved slightly. The other thing I have, Mr. Chairman, is we have a young lady who is about to go on maternity leave under the FMLA Maternity Leave Act. And with the board's permission, we've made arrangements to hire two temporary people to come in and fill that position so that we don't have a vacant position in the finance department. But we need permission to exceed the 28 hours per week, but not exceed the 30-hour threshold in federal law. The board set a 28-hour threshold. We're going to need to work this person 29 hours in order to make up the time. So we need your permission to do that, sir. That's it. I'm done.
Very good.
Is there to be a motion for that?
Do you want a motion for that?
Yes, because you did set a policy.
Motion by Rick, second by Regina. All those in favor?
Why are we hiring two to fill one?
We can't get first of all, we can't work a part-time person more than 28 hours a week to start with.
Okay.
So it's a 40-hour position. In order to fill a position, we need two people and not exceed the threshold.
Okay. And we'll only be going the 20 hours, 40 hours, I mean?
We'll only be doing 39 hours at the most between the two of them.
Between the two.
Right. So we won't exceed the federal limit of 30 with anyone.
Okay. All right.
And can we just get a more, I support the motion, can we get a detailed motion, more detailed than we support that?
If you want.
I would like that. Two people.
All right.
Replacing an
employee.
Motion
would be to hire two part-time people.
Yes, sir.
No person to work, temporary people, during the FMLA absence of one of our employees. And the total number of hours worked by any employee will not exceed 29 hours in a week.
And I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Any questions for the town manager? Regina.
So on the harbor dredging, that you have just sent a letter out to Senator Shaheen to see if she is able to get funds in order to have that done?
We sent a letter in conjunction with the Pease Ports and Harbors Authority, the Eastman's Docks, the Yankee Fishermen's Cooperative, the Hampton River Marina, and the town of Seabrook, who are all users of the harbor.
Right. Okay, perfect. Thank you.
I'm set, Jim. Phil, all set. Rick?
So when people get the discount or, you know, the, what do you call it? The
abatement
for being, you know, not falling within the certain guidelines when they're up to 80 years old.
Yes.
Do they have to apply for that every year?
No, sir, they do not. But there is a provision in the regulations of the Department of Revenue that every 5 years we have to verify their eligibility again. So we send them a letter. We check to see if they're on the checklist. Let's check to see if they own the property and they're still there. And we do verify that they are still living there once every 5 years, so they continue to be eligible for the exemption.
So when their age changes, like let's say one was 79 last year and they're 80 this year, when does the time, when would they?
They have to be 80 after April 1st.
So if they're 80 before then.
If they're 80 before them, it's automatic. If April 1st is the date in which all changes are made in real estate taxes. Mm-hmm. So that's the last day. If you turn 80 on April 15th, for instance, you got to wait a year.
Okay. So you'll know if someone was 79 last year that going to go into another category when they're 80.
Yes, and we keep track of those, and we check them every year, and we do track them by age and their birth date.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay.
I was down the river yesterday and looking at it, and once you had mentioned it to me last week, you get down there and you really notice how much
big difference.
How much that banking is eating away on both, as you're headed south, both sides of the road.
One of the things we're worried about there is the fact that we have a submerged forced sewer main that runs on the west side of the bridge through the harbor base and up through that dune area, and then up underneath the highway and down into Sun Valley. So we're being very cautious about that and keeping a close eye on where that line is.
Okay. Next thing we have is old business. 815 Ocean Boulevard, the Perrine and Schuler sewer line reduction. Your location.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Tim Phoenix. I'm from Hopeful Phoenix, Gormley & Roberts in Portsmouth. I'm here tonight on behalf of Brad Schuler. Brad is in the second row to your left. His wife, Cindy, is out of state tonight, so she's not here. Brief history of this matter is that Brad and Cindy own 815 Ocean Boulevard, a long existing home, has no garage. We received roughly a year ago, I don't remember exactly, but roughly a year ago, they got a variance and permission to build an addition on the house, which includes a garage and living space above. As they prepared for construction and DigSafe was called, it was learned that there was an existing town sewer line that only services three property, but it runs along the back of their property. And as you may recall, the addition, when built, was going to be approximately 6 feet from that sewer line. We came in and asked this board for permission to leave the sewer line and related easement where it was. The Department of Public Works did not like that. They thought it was too close. And on a close vote, the board denied our request. Since that time, which was October timeframe, our engineers, MSC, through Corey Caldwell, primarily, who's here coincidentally on another matter tonight, worked to design newly located line which pushes it more to the center of the 20-foot easement. I submitted a letter of February 3rd, 2017, to the board through Mark Gerald, Town Council, with a copy of the plan that I had been informed that DPW, through Chris Jacobs, had approved. I presume you folks got a copy of that letter. Subsequently, on February 9th, Chris Jacobs issued a letter to Corey, which I presume you have, that accepts the new location and the new plan subject to a number of conditions. Mark Gerald was kind enough to forward these things to me, put it on the agenda, and also to forward me some drafts of some documents and other situations which might be used to proceed. So we're here to ask for your permission to permit the sewer line to be placed as outlined in the plans and as accepted by Chris Jacobs. His letter of February 9th has A through F of requests and conditions. We're fine with all of it with the exception of one thing. And with apologies to Mark, I think Mark, is he still here?
Yeah.
Oh, there he is. With apologies to Mark, I did not raise this to him prior to tonight because it didn't click to me. The only issue that we have is item C of the February 9th letter, which I will read from Mr. Jacobs. We accept your offer for an access easement over the south and west portions of 815 Ocean Boulevard for the purpose of inspection, cleaning, and maintaining the reconstructed sewer mains and manholes.
We respectfully request that a waiver of liability for any damages caused by our men or equipment in the process of carrying out our work be included with the access easement. The owner's legal counsel will need to work with the town's legal counsel to prepare the access easement. As I said, Mark sent me a draft of a form of access easement, which we have no problem with. We have no issue with the rest of the requirements set forth in Mr. Jacobs' letter. But I do, on behalf of my client, request that the board not enforce item C once this line is in place and it's part of the regular sewer, just like there's a line there today. I don't think it's fair and reasonable for the owners of the property to be releasing the town from liability anytime it comes out to maintain or work on the line in the future. The rights and responsibilities of the parties once the line's in should be as they are today, and to release from future liability of the town on any and all occasions, no matter what the town does, if they're negligent, et cetera, does not seem to me to be a fair and reasonable request. Again, I would normally have at least vetted this, my concern with Mark before tonight, so he might be more prepared. I failed to do so, so he's hearing me comment for the first time, but it's a pretty straightforward issue. So I asked you to approve the moving of the line according to the plan that Chris Jacobs has approved, and require us to comply with the terms of his February 9th letter, except for the release from any and all future liability. I'll be happy to answer any questions. Brad's here, and I would impose upon Corey, even though he's not here for me, that if there are any questions he can answer, that he would help me out. Right? Thanks.
Any questions from the board?
Can we hear from Jen and Mark?
Yep. Jen, Mark, you want to weigh into this?
We're working on the newly found information.
Okay.
I apologize for that.
Having thought this through a little bit, I'm not sure we need another access easement in that it, on their property, it already, we do have access already under the existing terms of their deed. So I don't think we need a new easement. And I'll let Jen explain why the language of the waiver of liability.
So we left the liability in, but what I just wanted to check was under the existing agreement that we have, just like we already have access to it, we also have an indemnity agreement that says that the lessee covenants and agrees that it will hold the lessor harmless for any claims of demand of any kind, including but not limited to claims of property damage, personal injury, wrongful death, arising out of any accident of the premise or occasioned by any nuisance made or suffered on the premise or fire on their casualty. And sorry, I'm reading this for the first time now that I'm reading that.
Yes, this language is in the lease for the abutting property. By virtue of the line being moved over as it is, if the 10 feet is exercised on the westerly side, that will put the town into the property of the abutter. And therefore, we were looking at the abutters. The abutter is under a leased land situation with the town. That's why Jen is looking at that. But there's a rationale for why Chris was wanting the hold harmless from liability language.
Right, because as we enter, I mean, we're coming back through there. There are pavers through there. Their building is going to be, you know, they have moved it so that we do have the 10 feet and the 10 feet. But we may need to be able to go back there and do access, do maintenance. And we generally do ask for that release of liability when we are on another property trying to maintain our sewer system. I mean, it is not uncommon for any of the, you know, sewer agreements that we have done, especially when we are on someone else's property.
And you already have that in the present easement?
In the adjacent properties.
Right.
We have it. So it would be consistent with what, you know, other things we've asked. We don't need another easement because the deed has it in.
Right.
But that does not have the liability language.
Go ahead.
All set, Jen?
Yes.
Thank you. Again, I do apologize. I put these two at an unfair advantage, potentially, by raising this now. But I would say I have a copy of the actual easement in place, and there's nothing in our easement, which goes back to previous owners, but there's not, the easement describes the easement, the location, and I think that it, Mark is correct, that already exists and it will be within it. There's nothing in that about liability, and again, I'm not concerned about the town being released from liability while this is being installed. But once it's installed, say 10 or 15 years from now, just like today, if the town came to the existing line and something happened and the town did something wrong and it created damages on our property, we would have whatever rights we have. And I don't understand why that should change as a result of moving a line so that it is more centered in the easement where it should be in the first place. It's as simple as that. Thank you.
And just so we're clear, the you have in front of you the February 27th memo from Fred. Was that passed out?
Yeah.
From Chris Jacobs, which outlines the terms A through F. As my understanding, this the work to be done to move the line would be at the expense of the. Of the eight owners of 815 Ocean Boulevard, is that right?
Yeah, that is correct. I mean, that's only fair that the town shouldn't have to pay for us to move a line for our purposes.
And so the recommendation is that this work be the board, as sewer commissioners, move to allow this work at the expense of the property owners at 815 Ocean Boulevard, subject to the conditions set forth in the memorandum from Chris Jacobs.
If I may ask, is that memorandum a recitation of what's in our February 9th letter, essentially?
With the exception of removing the easement language, because the deed already has the easement language in it.
Got it. Okay. I'm fine. Thank you. With my noted exception, the rest of it's fine with me. Thank you.
Regina, any questions?
So the way their current easement stands now is there is no waiver of liability for these property owners.
For this property, correct?
In the deed, yes.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Jim?
Yeah, in moving the sewer line, it's making it easier to get at it, isn't it? Or more difficult?
It's giving us the sufficient width to what we asked for in case it needed maintenance line. So in reality, it's the same.
We have the width now.
Right, but when they put the addition, it would not have the width. So with the movement, it would give us the same as we have today. And it's in the town, it's the town sewer line, right?
Correct. That's correct.
Okay.
Bill?
Yeah, I supported this. Was in the minority when you were in last time. I support council's, unless there's some other reason that you can give, I support the residents, and they've been very compliant, they've been very patient. They pay a lot of money in taxes, and I agree with the attorney from Portsmouth's assertion that it's not there now. I don't see why we have to impose it, and I'm in support of the taxpayers' intent, their scheme of maneuver, and I'm prepared to vote for that. Thank you.
Rick?
I'm in the same position as Bill, having supported this previously.
Okay. So we need a motion.
I'll make a motion.
What's the motion?
To approve.
Mark,
according to Chris Jacobs' terms, right, with the exception of removing the waiver of liability.
You want to tighten that up, Mark.
Yeah, sure. The motion would be to approve the grant permission as sewer commissioners for the moving of the sewer line at the expense of the owners of 815 Ocean Boulevard, subject to the conditions set forth in Chris Jacobs' memo dated February 27, 2017, with the exception of paragraph C.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second it.
Any other questions? All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you. Take care.
Next thing we have is Liberty Lane Crossroads Sewer.
I'm going to move over here.
Yeah,
You're welcome. Thank you.
Chairman, members of the Board of Selectmen. My name is Ovid Lamontang with the law firm of Bernstein Shore. I represent the Asset Title and Seacoast Crossroad Realty, owners of property on Liberty Lane. And I thought it would be worth perhaps doing a quick summary of what brings us here tonight and sort of the history since we've last spoken, or at least had representatives here, about the sewer system. With me this evening is Corey Caldwell, who's just placed the schematic on the board here for us to look at if we need to. Also, Steve Paquette, who represents the cornerstone developer, Stephen Crook, who's here in the, with us today. And I thank Town Council Mark Gerald for his good work over the last few weeks to try to bring this to some, I hope, successful conclusion. Just by way of background, you may recall that we are here largely because of conditions that were imposed on the Cornerstone development on February 10th of 2016 by the Hampton Planning Board. Items number 6 through 9 principally are requiring, among other things, the creation of a Liberty Lane Sewer Association governing the sewer, the private sewer that's owned by private interests and accessed by those abutters along Liberty Lane. The conditions of the site for the site approval or site plan approval were delayed in implementation largely because in conducting title work, we all discovered that there was a conservation easement on the part of the property being developed by Cornerstone. So we appeared before you over the course of the spring and into the summer to reach a resolution about essentially releasing the conservation easement in exchange for a property exchange. That was approved by the Rockingham County Probate Court. It is now stayed, that order is stayed pending a conclusion of the Cornerstone project. We then turn our attention to the site, the sewer conditions and the site plan, and develop some documents. And we came at the end of August to what appeared at the time to be an impasse. I'd like to say in hindsight, and in retrospect, we'd call it an inflection point. And what really prompted the impasse was the question of who owned the sewer connection pipe running under Route 101 between Manhole Zero and Langdale Drive. There was a position of the town that it was the private sewer system's connection running underneath Route 101, and our position was at the time that it was, in fact, the town's. That prompted all of us to do research about this issue. And we were unable to find a conclusive resolution to the question. Since then, there's been a proposal made that I believe will now allow us to move forward, and that is essentially to have the sewer connection between Manhole Zero and Langdale Drive replaced, improved, enhanced at the cost of the developers and at the cost of the Liberty Lane Sewer Association, which I'll mention in a minute. Ultimately, once it meets specifications, for the town to take over and accept that sewer connection as its responsibility. And that breakthrough allowed us to work now with members of the private owners in the Liberty Lane sewer community. At the same time we were dealing with the sewer connection, we also were learning about certain positions being taken by some of the owners on Liberty Lane West, which are Unitil and Farley White, the successor to Wheelabrator. In 1995, they created the Liberty Lane West Owners Association. And under their covenants, after 20 years, they took the position that title to the private sewer system was conveyed to them. And therefore, they own the sewer system. Well, obviously, we didn't agree with that, so we engaged, entered into negotiations with them. And we are continuing to finalize the negotiations. I've shared with Town Council a inter-sewer association agreement, which provides essentially that the private sewer system, whatever rights or claims Liberty Lane West would make, was going to be conveyed to Liberty Lane Sewer Association, the new sewer association, and the conditions of the site plan approval of Cornerstone requires to be created. The Liberty Lane Sewer Association would essentially take control and responsibility for the private sewer system, and with certain participation by the Liberty Lane West Owners Association. Liberty Lane Sewer Association, once created, which will happen very soon if the board allows us to proceed, would essentially be the one entity that the town could go to address any issues on the private sewer system at Liberty Lane. Whether or not some of the current owners choose to become members of the Liberty Lane Sewer Association, we believe that we have the legal remedies and rights to compel compliance with repairs and so forth. Today, for example, a council for the Finley Group, RMMC, which owns One Liberty Lane, acknowledged the responsibility for the pipe running. That's a gravity-fed pipe running from their building to manhole zero. And there are covenants that we believe will compel them and require them to maintain that pipe. Whether they are members of the Liberty Lane Sewer Association really is not relevant to the question, will there be an association that can respond to the town's needs and demands over time regarding this prior sewer association? We've submitted to the town updated documents that were previously reviewed and looked at back in August that now make some revisions. We have the whole harmless agreement that's required as a condition of the Cornerstone project. We have asked, and the town council has agreed, to basically stagger the whole harmless. That is, the Liberty Lane Sewer Association is the primary indemnitor. And then if failing that, then the members become responsible secondarily. So it makes, again, the Liberty Lane Sewer Association as the entity that was going to be responsive to the town. Yeah. We have some our own covenants and bylaws and so forth as we create this Liberty Lane Sewer Association. Since, again, August, a third issue has arisen, which is the question of easement rights. And town council is quite correct that if the town is going to accept responsibility and ownership of the sewer connection, it will need an easement to access manhole zero and to service that sewer connection. And my clients are prepared to grant that easement. Some of it will be across asset title property, and there may be some rights that Liberty Lane Sewer Association would need to grant as well on an easement level for that piece. And we're not asking for any compensation for that. There's a second easement that we were requested to convey, and this would be largely conveyance by asset title to create a basically an easement right to place a sewer pipe from manhole zero all the way to the west side of Hampton so that west side, Hampton owners could access the municipal system if and when the town chose to create that pipe or construct the pipe to connect the west side of Hampton, as I understand it, to the municipal system, bypassing essentially the private Liberty Lane sewer. My clients have authorized me to offer that they will convey the easement as depicted by town council and the town, along with some language similar to those easements that you already currently have, on the condition that in the event that the town chooses and elects to construct the pipe, that the town would then, with asset title, enter into a takings procedure, essentially, determining the value of that easement and the diminution of my client's property at that time as a condition for proceeding. It seems to me that is a reasonable request to make of the town. There's no question that even in conveying the easement in the first place, without any pipe in the ground, there is a diminution of value, a limitation on the ability of my clients to develop that property. Notwithstanding that limitation, which they're willing to accept, once, in fact, the pipe is ever constructed, and who knows what time that will be, 10 years from now, 50 years from now, it would be an appropriate time to assess the impact of that for the purposes of the town and my clients or their successors and interest. And so the recommendation that I'm offering and authorized to make is to enter into that second easement on the condition that the compensation would only be due if and when the town chooses to access it by constructing the pipe. This is a very important project, as you all know. And not only the Cornerstone project, but now the hotel near CR's is being suspended. Its approval is being suspended pending the resolution of the sewer issue at Liberty Lane. The combined value of these projects is about $40 million in construction, about $700,000 a year to the tax rolls of the town. And, you know, the number of permanent jobs are estimated to be about 230 permanent jobs, along with, if this goes forward, the conveyance to the town of wetlands mitigation land, as well as land that will offset the conservation easement that's going to be released. This is a very important project, I understand, and I know, for the town of Hampton. It's certainly important for the developers and my clients who are looking to add value to the town in an area that is perfectly suited for development. It's been a long process. I have now made contact and friends with counsel for all the owners in Liberty Lane Sewer Association. So we've been in communication with everyone. They're all on board, at least they are all aware of what's happening. The Cornerstone developer, as well as the hotel, support this project, want to become members of the Liberty Lane Sewer Association. I believe once we finalize the agreement with the Liberty Lane West Owners Association, which is critical, Unitil and Farley White, by extension, will be part of this solution. And then I expect that CRs, which is the former Bonta, through Mr. Rolichek, will join as well. He's currently under a sewer disposal agreement with Asset Title. It would be much more beneficial to him, in my opinion, to join the Liberty Lane Sewer Association and share the cost, the burden, the responsibility across a number of owners. So I believe we've reached agreement, at least in principle, and I would urge the board to authorize and enable, essentially, the town to go forward and finalize these agreements, documents, so that the project can move forward fairly quickly here. And I thank you and the town, and particularly the town council, for patience and understanding and flexibility and reaching what I think is a very good compromise. Compromise means everybody gives a little bit, and there's no question that's happening here to enable this project to go forward. And I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Do you want
to? Yeah, I just wanted to add, in relationship to the pipe, sewer pipe itself under 101, when the question came up as to who owned it, there was a examination of the pipe made, at which time it was found that it was significantly clogged, at which time an order issued to those who are current users of the pipe to attempt to clean it, which proved to be very difficult in that the material within the pipe had basically petrified. And so when we talk about the agreement that's been offered at the expense of the association to replace the pipe, that has been spelled out in a number of terms, which include the association's removing the sewer pipe, existing sewer pipe under Route 101, from the existing sleeve, and removing the water pipe that also runs within that sleeve. Right. The water pipe will be relocated to a different location, and then the once that sleeve is emptied of its current occupants, there will be an evaluation done of the sleeve, the metal sleeve, to determine whether it's suitable for continued use as a conduit for a sewer pipe. And what is contemplated is that it will likely be able to continue to serve as the location of the sewer pipe, either by lining the current sleeve or inserting a new sleeve.
Right.
And when a new sewer pipe is inserted in that location, it will be of a larger diameter to better serve the contemplated users of the Liberty Lane area. A number of a condominium of five vacant lots has already been approved by the planning board. Those would be future users, in addition to the Cornerstone and the office project that's coming before the planning board this Wednesday. And so these are that's another aspect of this that is resolved by virtue of the terms that have been put forth. The town would assume the ownership of the new sewer pipe once it is installed at the expense of the association.
And I want to commend also the good work of Corey Caldwell, who's worked with Aquarian Water to develop an alternative route for the water main. Just for historical reference, the trench permit that was issued by the state of New Hampshire was in 1969 for purposes of allowing the water main to go under Route 101. And following that time, in the mid-70s, the sewer pipe was added. And the water line and the sewer pipe are too close by state standard to be located within that one sleeve. So it appears that Aquarian is quite not only open but encouraging of the relocation of the water line out of that sleeve and through an alternate route that will give more opportunities for water access.
I do want to emphasize that the five documents that have been presented as far as creating the Liberty Lane Sewer Association have been vetted by a group of us at the town office, including the assistant town manager, the public works director, who's a licensed professional engineer, as well as the deputy director of public works, also a licensed professional engineer, and also our town planner and town manager and myself. So we have looked at these documents very closely and have worked very closely with Attorney Lamontagne and his office in making changes to these documents to get them to the point where we believe they can be recommended to you.
Any questions from the board? Regina?
Thank you very much for the explanations. And it sounds like you're looking for us to approve these five documents so that the Liberty Lane Association can be formed and this work can begin and we can begin development down there.
That's correct. The Crossroads has been on the verge of being able to start the development on their end and have fortunately hung in there with us through this process and would like to get started very soon. But of course, until the recording of their site plan occurs, along with these association documents, along with the documents for the conservation easement swap that have been approved by the probate court, they can't. That's all in conjunction with the closing on the property.
So this is the first step to get everything in line with moving forward.
Exactly. Thank you.
Jim?
Yeah, my only concern is that this whole thing has been a mess and a long process because of sloppy work done in the 70s. When it was initially put in, not documenting who owned what and what. So I want to make sure that when this is finalized, that we know exactly who's responsible for what, who owns what the easement is going to be, you know, so there's nothing vague about it, so that in the future when somebody wants to develop, they can go in and say, okay, yeah, these guys are the guys that you have to go see, da-da-da-da, every I dotted, every T crossed, exactly.
Yeah.
And we know who's responsible financially so that later on it doesn't come back, well, we kind of didn't figure that one out maybe first, so let's make sure everything is done properly.
Right, and in that vein, I would like to say that these five documents that I've mentioned to you very specifically call for this new Liberty Lane Association to be responsible for the entire private system, regardless of who it serves, and including the pipe that runs under Route 101 between Sewer Manhole Zero and Langdale Drive. At such, and the town will not be responsible until such point as the sewer pipe is replaced. And so that very specifically sets forth the terms that you are concerned about.
Right. I can assure you I do not want to make a career out of being a sewer lawyer.
Yeah.
I want this to be my one and done. And we are doing everything possible to do to achieve the results that you suggested, and that is to make sure we know who's responsible for what going forward so we're not back here 10, 20 years ago trying to unscramble the eggs again.
Bill.
Yeah, you've got the Liberty Lane Sewer Association, their primary. Nice job, Esquire. I'm sure you anticipated that going to law school. Good job. Liberty Lane West is subordinate, but Liberty Lane Sewer is the primary. They can compel the subordinate sewer association. You've got remedies, you've got covenants, blah, blah, blah. You've run it by Gerald on the easements. We've all done the good things. Can't be a restaurant, can be this, different programs, different. Now we're into the second easement, and we've got contingencies for that. Asset title, you're going to convey conditionally. There's going to be, if a diminution, you guys get together again and reacquaint each other, and then we pay the thing. If I hear another lawyer speak about pipes today, I'm going to lose my mind. And that goes back to the Ocean Boulevard beforehand. Having said that, this is what separates us from governments and municipalities like Flint, Michigan, that can't get water out of the ground. And I'm very impressed with Mr. Welch and his department heads, and I'm very impressed with our Esquire, and very impressed with your outfits and any others that have been patient. It seems like it's taken a long time, but it's a big project, and it's important to get it done right. And I commend all of you and fully support the motion that's been prepared. Thank you.
Rick?
Thank you for bringing it to a conclusion.
Thank you.
Been a lot of crap getting to this point, hasn't it?
No pun intended, I know.
So in conjunction with Attorney Lamontagne, the motion you have before you was what is recommended for this evening.
All right, I'll read the motion. I hereby move to approve in concept the five documents associated with forming the Liberty Lane Sewer Association to be responsible for the entire private sewer program shown on the sewer and pumping stations schematic, contingent upon the following: one, finalization of the five documents in form agreeable to the town manager, public works director, and town attorney, that will result in the creation of the Liberty Lane Sewer Association, an agreement relating to the sewer services, and a hold harmless indemnification agreements by which the association will be responsible. Two, returning to the probate court to jointly ask for the implementation of the conservation easement swap previously approved. Three, payment of the attorney's fees by Cornerstone incurred by the town for the review of the aforementioned documents. Four, memorialization of the agreements between the town and the new association related to the remediation of the sleeve and the sewer pipe under Route 1 as outlined. And five, memorialization of the agreement for the easements as outlined and retained to the access for maintenance of the sleeve, the sewer pipe under Route 101, and related future connection to the sewer system by the town of Hampton utilizing the new sewer pipe, and authorize the town manager to execute any documents requiring the signatures of the selectmen at the sewer commissioners to effectuate the above. So, it is a mouthful. I'll make that motion. Seconded by Jim. Any questions? All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll do it moving forward.
Thank you. Good job. Thank you.
Anything else on the old business?
I just have one thing I wanted to bring up. A couple people have questioned on our appeal for the administrative order. I guess it's confusing people because we're saying in paragraph S, the administrative order is unlawful and unreasonable. The town has already undertaken a considerable cost, the correction of the condition causing contaminants to enter the water system in the Hampton Tidal Marsh. And then we say there is no evidence that another failure is probable or likely. So some people, by reading those two sentences, are thinking that, well, why do we have this warrant article? Pipes got fixed. You know, this. I can't help but almost laugh when I say this. Yep. But I was wondering, maybe Mr. Manager or even Town Council, if you could maybe explain why this was worded the way it was when we sent the appeal in, just to clarify.
Well, first of all, if this is going to happen, it's going to be replaced. the position is that it should be the town doing this work, not the state. Okay, the taxpayers, in our opinion, are the ones who have the jurisdiction to approve, and they should have the jurisdiction to regulate. Okay, the reason that the appeal has been filed is because the law says without filing an appeal, we have no voice in what happens in this entire system. It's completely out of our control, and we don't want that to be out of the control of the taxpayers of the town and the residents who live here. The reality is that we have a number of pipes. Actually, there are four pipes running through the marsh. Two were discontinued before, and these two that are there now that are currently operating are the two that we rely upon to move effluent from the Church Street station over to the treatment plant. The point is that we have no way of maintaining those pipes, absolutely none. We also have no way of cleaning or inspecting them. Pipes of this nature need to be cleaned and inspected on a regular basis. We need to know the condition of those pipes, and we're unable to do that without spending millions of dollars to, in fact, dig them all up to look at the inside of them in three or four different places and clean them out, which may or may not be possible depending upon how deep the pipe is. And some of those pipes are pretty deep. They actually run underneath the rivers that are out there in the marsh. If you can't maintain it, then there's no guarantee that you'll be able to operate it. The conversations that we have had with the state and the EPA are such that should we, in fact, have another failure of a pipe, it won't be a question about waiving penalties and fees. They'll be assessed, and we will have to pay those out of the taxes that are raised by the taxpayers, and we don't really want to do that.
Right.
It's like, I guess it's like owning a 1948 motor scooter, and if you need to have work done on it, you need to have work done on it. And that's kind of what we have here. We have 50-year-old pipes running through the marsh that can fail at any time. It could be because of an earthquake. It could be a failure somewhere in the piping system that's out there that we have no way of examining. We have no way of cleaning the pipes to send a camera down through them to photograph it to see if there is a problem. So we're kind of in the dark. And we have to trust in the good Lord to protect us. And we know that if we really want to be protected and we really want to have a system that works and will account for the growth that's currently going on at the beach, we need to have bigger pipes, and we need to have in an area where we can get at them at any time. So that's the reason the article's in there. That and a whole bunch of real fancy engineering terminologies that I'm not going to get into because we'd be here for 3 hours trying to explain what they mean. But the reality is that we need to maintain it just like we maintain our personal homes. And they need to be reliable at all times without question, and we need to be able to repair them and examine them at all times and clean them at least once a year, and we can't do that now.
Thank you for clarifying.
Anything else in the old business?
Negative.
New business.
I just want to ask, sure. do you have an example that you can give us of when the state did fine communities?
I can't remember the names of the two towns, but two towns have been fined for failure to repair sewer lines in the state of New Hampshire. It's an unusual event because what happens is if you have a failure, they give you a notice and you're required to fix it. And if you do, there's nothing more said. However, if the pipe does rupture again, and this has happened before, then you're subject to those fines. And I know they don't want to give them because they're just a pain in the neck to try to give and try to collect, as a matter of fact, because that money should really be going to fix it, not finding people. If I'm not mistaken, one of those towns, as I recall, I think it was Newmarket, that had a problem with a sewer line that failed twice. And there was a fine associated with it. I know that the state does, and I did pay a fine in one of the towns I worked in New Hampshire, because they failed to correct a problem. Very small fine, but it was a fine nevertheless. And it did not represent a breach into a water body. that's about as serious as you can get. That's the Flint, Michigan situation all over again, where you breach something that's a significant contaminant into a water body. So we don't want to do that, and I don't think we will do it. We'll do what we need to do, and I think the town will do what they feel they need to do, and we'll move forward with it.
December 2013, Newmarket faces $37,500 a day fine if wastewater.
Yeah, but did they do it? That's what I'm saying. No, they didn't. And Hampton has a long history of working with the state, and they'll continue to do that. We have always worked very closely with the state, and we've never had a problem in the past.
That's why we haven't been fined before.
Yes. Yep. And we work closely with them.
Right.
Okay, new business. 436 to 438 Lafayette Road driveway permit.
I'm going to yield to Public Works.
Okay.
They issue driveway permits. And I know she's here, but she's probably a bigger expert at this because she does it every day. And I haven't been doing them for the last 4 or 5 years.
So the reason a driveway permit is here before the Board of Selectmen comes down to really the location. This application was brought in to us in the beginning of January. It is for a driveway. To the best way I can describe where 436, 448 is the Bai Chai restaurant. You have the model airplane place, and then you have the Attorney Green building right there. They are looking for a driveway permit between the two buildings. Right now, they have a white fence up. There's utility pole there. I am trying to pull up a picture to show you, but that's not working, so you'll have to trust me that there's a white fence there and the utility pole. Originally, when I looked at it, I was very hesitant. You know, how can that be a driveway? But they meet the dimensional requirements as far as 2 feet from a property line. They are not greater than the width that is required. What becomes the obstacles in this driveway permit are what I see as two things. One, something from the utility, saying that they don't have an issue with a driveway that close to one of their utility poles. My understanding is that the applicant has spoken to Unitil, and that they wanted a concrete bollard placed to protect it, and they were going to write a letter as such. I have not seen that, but that it was happening. The other concern I see is that, if you recall, we have head-on parking spaces into the sidewalk there along that whole frontage. This would be removing 2 parking spaces. We don't have the authority to remove parking spaces within the Public Works Department. That falls here. So as a whole, that's why there's a driveway permit here at the Board of Selectmen. So I started the conversation with Fred going, okay, what do we do next? And, well, we wrote the conditions to the applicant, get us the letter from Unitil, request the Board of Selectmen that you be put on the agenda to have this discussion and provide an updated map for me that shows that you meet all the dimensional requirements that they have done.
Do you have the plan?
Yep.
I'm just looking at this right here, and you're saying loose.
I gave you the picture in your packet. Right. I don't have it in mine, unfortunately.
Two spaces, when in fact, I would think you're going to lose 3.
There's some working that when they are restriped that they could fit moving to.
Restripe the spaces.
Yeah.
Okay. Where's the Odd Fellows building? Yeah.
Any questions from the board?
Right here.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
It may be worth noting that I think there was a planning board approval when the Odd Fellows building was replaced that showed some spaces out partially owned by the town but partially owned privately. I'm not sure if any of those spaces are affected by this.
Where would those spaces be?
If the driveway
is... Well, the property line for Odd Fellows. Oh, I see what you're saying. In between those two.
It just may be worth... those are diagonal spaces, and I just don't know if they extend over into what... where the proposed driveway is. It may be worth looking into that before a decision is made.
If they do, they'd be on the old Oddfellows property.
Yeah, what I'm saying, Fred, is that the spaces are diagonal with the diagonal coming
I understand, but
southeast.
As you look down northeast. Lafayette Road, you have the Oddfellows property steps out into the roadway.
Right.
You get down to where this driveway would be, the property line steps back.
Okay.
So it would appear that those spaces are in fact on town property in front of this property. And what would have to happen is if you eliminate only two spaces, you would have to remark the street just to make sure that only two spaces were eliminated.
Why? What is this driveway servicing?
All right, so that was the part of the story I left out for you. The applicant would have better described it for you.
And the rest of the story is?
Yes. So, fortunately, unfortunately, I'm not going to put a term to it. There are some disagreements within the whole Depot Square area as far as to who has what rights to what spaces related to parking. Access, there are all bunch of cross-access easements. We have a drainage easement in there, as you remember, from when we did the High Street project. Right now, one of the other owners, and everybody sees me home, air quotes, because I didn't look through the whole deeds, rightfully has put up a restriction that prevents people from getting into this side area from the back. So it has the room for the two cars there, like room that supports the apartments that are above, but now that the bollards are in the back there, there's no way to use those spaces. You have it blocked off with the parking and the fence from one side and the bollards from the other.
Does that person use those as parking, or have they just blocked off access?
One person has blocked off access. This applicant has used it for parking in the past.
For access to his parking or for parking?
Actual parking. He can't get to it now.
All right.
Because it has been blocked.
Just blocked.
Yeah.
And that person's not using it for anything?
No, because it's his property. And this is where I'm saying it's agreements.
Yeah, so we...
So his option, what he came up with is, can I just get a driveway permit so I can use the spaces next to my house, or my building, excuse me, and have access right onto Lafayette Road versus going through Depot Square. And his proposal would do that.
I know when I was on the zoning board, at one point, there was one of the builders, I believe when they rebuilt that, there was a lot of information that was talked about when they rebuilt that Oddfellows in that space. And at one point, the developers were going to actually block it off, that it would have been a private driveway, parking area, that you couldn't even pull in there from the road. They could have had it so that you could just drive in there and they could have used the parking and no one else could have. But somehow, back when this building was approved, all of this was talked about then. I can't remember all the details.
Okay.
But when that building was approved, all of this was worked out about the parking, and that it probably was on conditions of approval, I would assume.
And again, you know, so, why I'm here, I'm trying to pull as much information as I can too.
This did come out, and it was, the way it was explained then, was these people were doing us a favor to let us use it like we use it. They had more control over it than the town did. But I can't remember all the details.
This plan here, which is dated January 20th, 2006.
Yeah, that's about...
Shows the driveway you're talking about.
Yes.
Okay, that comes in beside this building and a walkway beside it. And the Oddfellows built, the old Oddfellows lot is next door. So you have this proposed driveway that comes in here. And here's the diagonal parking down here.
And that was approved?
This is filed in the registry.
Yeah, they tried to come to an agreement that was agreeable to everybody at the time.
Yeah, isn't that the driveway for the Oddfellows as opposed to up here, Fred,
right,
where
I
it really
know.
Is? I think it's really up
here. It's up here.
It's up here.
Okay.
But I think it ought to be looked into just so.
I will. Safe. I can go through and look through the ZBA case.
That is exactly when I was on the zoning board. So.
Okay.
Yeah,
these people right now, they've had no place to park?
That's what I'm being told, that parking is very difficult because they're down two spaces, so it becomes this first-come, first-serve.
Right, and two people can't park on the street because it's winter.
Exactly.
Park in the town parking lot if they had to, huh?
And then it's a decent little walk to your apartment, right?
Just a tad.
Yeah, it's not... I mean, so we don't know whether there was a driveway... I mean, is that an approved driveway that they just don't have access to?
What I know is this, and that is that and Mark and I think can verify this, that every property owner is entitled to have access to their property. And what this applicant, I think, is saying is he no longer has access because he used to have access behind where everybody else had access. And that now has been blocked off and can't be used because somebody owns a triangular piece of land in the middle of this access and they put bollards in to block it off. Okay, so this person has no way to utilize parking on his own property and doesn't have vehicular access to the property. And the law says you've got to have access to your property. So you can't deny someone a driveway permit if they have the land to put the driveway on. And our regulations state that. So
why can't we approve that tonight?
That's up to you folks. It's not up
and
to me.
The driveway permit is given by you guys, right?
So we are given permits. The authority by the planning board to issue the driveway permits, provided that they meet the RSA, that they are safe. I mean, I have a laundry list of doing,
right.
And Fred is 100% right, that my catch-22 was he's entitled to a driveway. But I'm making sure, one, that we don't create a safety hazard, two, the pole is protected. You know, I'm looking now at the finer details of it all. I would like to look through and make sure that we don't issue a permit that's opposing a case, but that certainly could be a conditional approval, you know, upon
review.
Well, my problem is if you're going to put a driveway in there, they're either going to have to head in or pull in or back in.
Right.
So you're either going to be backing out onto Route 1 because they have no way to get in there and turn around.
Correct.
And that's kind of the problem I see is you're putting that right in the center of town.
Yep.
And I understand the gentleman's problem or the lady, whoever it is. But you're causing somebody to back out. We have a hard enough time with those people backing out of those spaces out in front. But they're backing out.
I mean, the same thing. I mean, the same thing as somebody backing out of a parking space. He's just...
That was unfortunately, that was exactly the applicant's argument. So he goes slow and becomes just another car being
another
one
car
of those parking
there and
spaces.
Backing out. I mean, I agree with you, but I think a person should
exactly
have the right...
Exactly some of my dilemma and why I'm here.
...to use their property. I mean, I think it's a shame that somebody has to block it off, but it
poses problems.
That's their property.
Yeah.
That's their property, right. So nice. Good.
That's the point well made. Somebody else's property, so they decided to deny access to anyone else.
I'd be happy to take a week to just look into this a little bit more and come back and tell you what I find, or if you don't want to... You know, if you're confident that we do the research, I am okay with the conditional that, you know, I do the research, that we do get the letter from Unitil. That's the one big one. I do want something from Unitil that says, you know, I've given
my... I'm going to make a motion that we conditionally approve this on... That she does the... Jen does
the driveway cut, the subject driveway cut. Second.
Have a motion second. Any other questions? All those in favor? I'm opposed. So,
okay.
4-1.
And I will either memo form or whatever, I'll let you know what I find out from the ZBA file that I can look through.
Before we do anything affirmative, we'll have the information.
Okay.
So everybody knows where we are.
Absolutely.
It's a good position to be in.
So, anything else on the new business? Any new business? Closing comments?
What was he going to say?
Well, I'm just going to say, I'm going to make a closing comment that what was the statements that were made at public notice today, all right, were not correct. When one member got up and said there's been a kangaroo court held meetings that is absolutely 100% incorrect. Nobody has gone after the budget committee, and nobody has gone after the budget committee chair. Those are I want to just make that I say those are absolutely incorrect, false statements.
And the other thing that was said that wasn't really correct is it says they were held up with the budget. When they actually were not held up with the budget, if you go back over a number of years, they were it was right into line with what in the past 5 years of when they've got the budget. So there was no holding up of the budget. Everything was got to them in a timely manner. How they chose to work with it, that was it.
I will just go back to that, and Jim raised it, and I said it before, and I think it bears repeating again today. These are the same people that just a few short years ago, at the 11th hour, came in on a $26 million budget, 25 and change, whatever it was then, without any notice, came in after a year of preparation, a whole year, and actually stepping into the operational facets of this fine corporation and listening to police chiefs and listening to town managers and taking the time and hearing, and I'll call it a diatribe tonight, and cut $700,000, wasn't it? $700,000?
Substantial, yeah.
It was over $500,000 and it passed that committee. And if you want to talk about a professional organization, they don't operate that way. And governments don't operate that way. And it's especially puzzling given the communication that came out this year that was in violation of New Hampshire law with private meetings going on online, no matter what Mrs. Woolsey says. And we've all looked at that. You don't need to be an attorney to know those were meetings. I'll just go back to that. And when we hear the same thing from the same people, and we hear the accusations, and we heard from Mr. Silberdick along the same thing, assassinating the schools, Mr. Welch's management, the board, then he gets into the operations of the directors. It's just no good. We do no good. Our directors do no good. Our leadership does no good. The school's too expensive. I don't know what planet they're living on. But things are going pretty darn good, and I will surmise, and I will end it by saying two things. One is that we've invited Mr. Silberdick to come in and speak with Mr. Welch, the finance director, and you, Mr. Bartle. Is he taking you up on any of that?
Not as yet, sir.
That he's so quick to opine and malign and put that in the paper, but he hasn't been in touch with you?
No, sir.
Okay, because that invitation from Mr. Silberdick stands at any time. And then if he wants to get in, I'll go further, if he wants to get in and you bring in your department heads that he maligns in the paper, I'm sure the board would love for all of our department heads to sit down without the Hampton Union and without the TV on and sit down and address his concerns. Happy to do that. And finally is it's election season, and that's really what's going on here. And I've just had it with all of that. And the final comment is we hire auditors to do our books. And the audit, if I may, Mr. Griffin, the audited statements are in this book today. And the people on the front were elected. Many of the people that spoke tonight have sat in this chair, and they weren't reelected, and they ran for reelection. And the voters have spoken. But when I stopped in, as I like to do, because I like to study the balance sheet and study the income statement, and I say that to the people that spoke tonight because they got their 4 minutes. And I spoke with the head auditor. And I said, comparing this town to other towns, what is our financial state and how is this town run? And quote, very, very well, end quote. So I would say that to the folks that came in, none of them have a financial background as this gentleman does, that it is run very, very well. And that was by the lead auditor that sat in your conference room today. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
One thing I want to ask you, I know you've been really busy. You've got a lot going on. You've been extremely busy. But Mary Louise did bring up a point. Is there at some point that we can have a preliminary statement to what you've found, maybe next week?
Right. Now that I've been out of the trial that we've just experienced.
And I mean, you were gone 3.5 days this past week at least.
Correct.
But if you could just look at, I don't want you to go through the whole thing, but just come up with some observations that you've found so far. And then as we move forward, we'll see about maybe getting them some training and so that they all know and so the public knows. So thank you.
Thank you.
Now, do we need a...
No, we'll just talk afterwards.
All right. Need a motion to adjourn?
At 21:05.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you.